Mr. Chairman, members of the Democratic Labour Party, friends, sympathizers, ladies and gentlemen, fellow citizens. I am very pleased to be here tonight at Heroe Square to participate in one of the most evangelical meetings I've ever attended of the Democratic Labour Party. Every speech heard here tonight lacked nothing in inspiration, lacked nothing in clarity, lacked nothing in the conviction that drives the Democratic Labour Party and that will continue to drive it until we hustle the Barbados Labour Party from the corridors of power. This meeting is taking place at a very difficult time in the life of Barbados and a very challenging time in the history of the party. Last Monday night, the parliamentary group of the party met to discuss a response to events which were unfolding in the Parliament of Barbados. And after sustained discussion and the interchange and exchange of ideas, a unanimous decision was reached that the members of the House of Assembly should not attend the sitting of the House yesterday. And I indicated that the senators would show solidarity with the members of the House. I sent an excuse to the Senate today, which was duly acknowledged by the president of that chamber. And I sent the excuse because I have never for one day in the Senate had any difficulty with Sir Fred Gollop. He has bent over backwards to protect the rights of minorities in that chamber. And I have seen him put members of the government in their places whenever they have tried to exceed the bounds of propriety and decency, and whenever they have tried to breach the provisions of the standing orders governing the Senate. And whenever I have had to stand up in that chamber to speak at the end of a session, invariably, as Dr. Law will attest, I have commented on the impartiality with which Sir Fred Gollop, the President of the Senate, has steered the deliberations of that chamber. So I thought I owed him a duty of respect to ask to be excused from today's sitting so that I could show solidarity with my colleagues in the House of Assembly. I have often silently and sometimes not so silently wished that my colleagues in the House would experience some of the good fortune which I experienced in the Senate. But alas, that is not so.
Edifall.
I want to say this. When difficult times like this happen, invariably you will have a few doubters around, you will have a few people whose feet will get cold, and that is quite human. But in life, the time comes when hard choices have to be made, and made on a matter of principle. And you always have to have some kind of reference point to which you can revert, and on the basis of which you can evaluate the choices you are going to make. have a number of reference points. The first one is this, that all that is required for an eagle to flourish is for good men and women to sit back and do nothing. That's all that is required for an eagle to flourish. That is a quotation that came from the lips of the English conservative politician of the 18th century, Mr. Edmund Burke. My second reference point is this, and this comes from the Cuban poet and essayist and revolutionary, Jose Martí. That a principle, even from the depths of a cave, is mightier than an army of many millions. Jose Martí said that in Spanish, and of course, it had to be translated by people. What I just said is just one translation of it. And you know what they say about translations? A translation is like a lover. The more attractive, the less faithful. The more faithful, the less attractive. But some translations, rather than say a principle even from the depths of a cave is mightier than an army of many millions, say a just cause, even from the depths of a cave, is mightier than a great army. And the third reference point also comes from Jose Martí, and this is the real reference point that has guided me and that will guide me in what I have to say here tonight. And it has to do with the fact that true men are required to do great things in this country. And Jose Martí said that a true man does not follow the path where advantage lies, but follows the path where duty lies. And he is the only practical man whose dreams of today will be the law of tomorrow. For he who has looked back on the essential course of history and has seen flaming and bleeding peoples seething in the cauldrons of the ages know that without a single exception, the future is on the side of duty. And the Democratic Labour Party and its parliamentary group had to take a decision on Monday night when we met, whether we were going to follow the path where advantage lies, or whether we were going to follow the path where duty lies.